Boise State won the toss, elected to receive the opening kickoff. Jason Sanders hits it at the 35. Out the back of the end zone for a touchback, so Boise State will have it at the 25 as we take a look at our Chick-fil-A starting lineup, beginning with the Broncos quarterback, the sophomore from Spokane, Washington, Brett Rippon. Versus New Mexico last year, three interceptions, took three sacks. Three INTs this year, and yet you talk to all the Bronco coaching staff, including Brian Harsin, they say, as a sophomore, he has developed in this offense at an incredible pace. They have so much confidence in number four.
He's right on schedule to where he's going to need to be, but on the road, ball security is a premium. He's got to take care of the football tonight.
Ripping over the middle. That is incomplete, intended for Spurbeck. And we take a look at the Boise State rest of the starting offense, and the offensive line is again shuffled.
Yeah, one of the things that New Mexico does a really nice job of is getting after the quarterback. So that offensive line led by Mario Yaku really has to provide some protection, not only against a pass, but some running lanes when they put it on the ground.
Mason Hampton at center out for the second straight game, so Baggett slides over to center. Yaku right guard, low snap, first touch, McNichols on the right side. Gets a couple, so the New Mexico defense, which, I mean, the numbers are not great for the New Mexico D, but they have a couple of big playmakers.
Yeah, Nick Diavanzo's really showed up on tape. He does an excellent job, actually leads the team in tackles from his defensive end spot, so he's going to be a factor for that offensive line for Boise, both in the pass and against the run. Here's a big first down, third down, where they're trying to get after the quarterback. Look for pressure a lot tonight.
Pressure picked up to the outside on third down. That pass is incomplete, intended for Anderson. So it's a three and out by the New Mexico defense to begin. Isaiah Brown there in coverage. What a start for New Mexico.
It couldn't have started any better. They had a great stop on second down against the run, and this ball just dies on Rippon. He's got a pretty good arm, but trying to throw across his body out to that flat leads to the incompletion and the punt, and this New Mexico offense is going to get the ball back early in this game.
Sean Whale will punt it to Chris Davis. Davis grabs it at the 29, and he is shoved back. A loss of four on the return by Davis. So now the question for New Mexico as the offense comes out there. Terrion Gibson, New Mexico told us yesterday, you're not going to see number seven out there for the Lobos. He came out for warm-ups. You saw him on the sideline, but Terrion Gibson averaging 13 yards per carry is not in that huddle. So we see Lamar Jordan and the option-based New Mexico offense with Tyrone Owens starting in the backfield in place of Gibson out with a hamstring injury. And off on first down, that's Darryl Chestnut. He'll get a whole lot more action tonight with Gibson out. Chick-fil-A starting lineups for the New Mexico offense begins with Lamar Jordan, the junior from Frisco, Texas, who has started, been benched, been mixed in as an option. Last year he had a rushing touchdown, a passing touchdown in this game, but because of the injury to Austin Apodaca out with a collarbone injury, the job is once again Lamar Jordan's.
Yeah, he's an extremely athletic, mobile quarterback that is well suited for this option style offense.
Jordan looks to pull it, and he is wrestled down on the edge by Tanner Vallejo, who missed the Utah State game. Vallejo back in the lineup for the Broncos, and a huge tackle for loss.
When you're watching Boise State on tape, one of the things you notice right away is how athletic their second-level linebackers are. Tanner Vallejo averaging 9 tackles per game shows you his closing speed. I think that they wanted to be able to get Jordan out here on the outside edge to possibly throw that football, but there was pretty tight coverage bringing up a third and long, the very thing that the Lobos hope to avoid tonight.
Very close to a horse collar on the tackle by Vallejo, but Legal tackle got away with it. So on third and long, the handoff to Owens, and New Mexico goes three and out in a hurry.
Very conservative play call, and that just shows you the coaches want to protect the football. They don't have a ton of confidence in Lamar Jordan's ability to be able to throw the football. Only eight attempts in their game a week ago against San Jose State on a third and long, very conservative. That's why it's important for the Lobos. They have to win on first and second down early to give them some chances on third down to convert.
New Mexico last in the nation in net punting. So you heard Brian Harsin tell Ginny before the game, we think we can make a difference in special teams. Butler back to return it. Good punt from Bojorquez. It bounces at the 25. Now Butler bobbles it back at the 18, gets back on top. But New Mexico downs it. It's a 57-yard punt. So the New Mexico special teams that have struggled so far able to pin Boise State back with a little bobble from Butler. Two drives, 2 yards of offense so far. That leads us right into tonight's three questions.
Well, the Lobos defensively had some concerns about covering this explosive wide receiver group of Boise, so pressure up front and getting to Rippon will certainly help that out. Can Boise State contain the option? Three of the last five losses have come against this style of offense, so that's going to be a big challenge for them and for the Lobos. Can they win the turnover battle? That's the thing that allowed them to get over the hump a year ago. It's going to be imperative for them to get some takeaways here tonight.
A Boise State team who is gone over 240 minutes without trailing. Let's see, that'll be 243 minutes now without trailing. McNichols in the backfield. He is shoved out for a loss. Neas Martin at corner and Dakota Cox at middle linebacker shove McNichols out for the loss.
Penetration up front at the line of scrimmage is the thing that will kill any sort of run game. There are defenders immediately in the backfield making McNichol alter his point of attack. That is a great way to get Boise behind the chains. Four really nice plays back-to-back to start this game for the Lobos.
Rippon flings it to the outside. That's Cedric Wilson, and he is wrestled down on the edge. Another tough tackle. Flag is down, but Isaiah Brown at corner is the one who gets the initial stop on Cedric Wilson. Jake Rothschild there as well. Now we check the flag.
A personal foul, grabbing the face mask by number four of the defense. It's a 15-yard penalty and an automatic first down.
And Brown had him wrapped up without the face mask.
They wanted to get a one-on-one situation there, but you see that right hand just pulling down Wilson's face. The officials are on it, but that was a good job in the open field getting the tackle, letting the pursuit come, but you have to be able to do so keeping your hands off the face mask of the ball carrier.
We saw the 16 penalties New Mexico committed last year, yet still won the game. McNichols blown up as he reaches the 34-yard line. Daniel Henry, the free safety, comes downhill to lay the lick on McNichols.
Been really impressed with Daniel Henry, third leading tackler on this team. Physical in that run support, getting into the alley. That's going to be a critical point for them tonight, their safety play. But they have to be disciplined because Boise can certainly take some shots over the top.
McNichols motions out. Rippon pumps. Throw it to McNichols on the edge, trying to get him in space. It's Brown again, and it looks like another face mask. This time it's Henry. Daniel Henry reaches in and is going to get the 15-yarder.
Personal foul, grabbing the face mask by number 14 of the defense. It's a 15-yard penalty and an automatic first down.
And that's really unfortunate because there were three other Lobo defenders that were right there pursuing. If Henry just stops and forces McNichol to get inside, he's going to get tackled from the pursuit. That's two huge plays and 30 yards that they've just helped this Boise offense that's been sputtering here early.
So near midfield, thanks to the penalties. Rowe, the tight end in motion. Madison in the backfield. Rippon, deep shot. Downfield, knocked away. Intended for Cedric Wilson with Isaiah Brown in coverage.
Talked about Boise's ability to be able to go over the top. There is a Lobo down. We'll get back to that in a second. But New Mexico playing a lot of man coverage. Boise will have its one-on-one shots, but so far unable to convert.
And it's Isaiah Brown who is down after that terrific play defending the deep shot off Wilson. Brown goes down, and he is still on the turf. The senior from San Antonio went to high school in Katy, Texas, outside of Houston. And Brown had one of the 15-yard face mask penalties. Daniel Henry the other, but he makes the big play in the pass game to knock that one away from Wilson.
Looks like his leg gets caught up underneath him here. Yeah, he rolls his ankle. This is a DB group, Carter, that a week ago had five pass breakups, and their margin for error is small. That's really going to hurt them because Brown is one of the players that's been pretty consistent for them on the back end.
For Boise State, they have minus 2 yards of offense, minus 2 passing, 0 yards rushing, 30 yards gained on penalties by the New Mexico defense.
And those are foolish penalties, in my opinion. You like the aggressiveness, but you just can't afford to help an offense that's as explosive as Boise's, particularly when you seem to have their number and have them corralled here early on.
Anderson motions out of the backfield. The ball was not yet marked ready for play. So Anderson will rejoin Rippon in the backfield. And now he will motion out. It's the ball's marked ready for play. So Rippon from the shotgun on second down and 10 to the air again. This one's complete. Wilson on the outside has the first down. Into Lobo territory. Wilson wrestled out at the 40-yard line. It's a gain of 12. Bijan Parker on the stop.
Yeah, right out of the gate. They go right after the replacement for Isaiah Brown. And there was no pressure that time. When you give Rippon time to set up and get his feet set, he's a pretty accurate passer.
It's Madison in the backfield. Spurbeck goes in motion. On first and 10. Rippon. Nowhere to go downfield. There's a flag down. Rippon will just fall down at the 33-yard line.
And this,
sure enough. Yeah, the mic was on, but we knew where you were going anyway.
Holding by number 66 of the offense. It's a 10-yard penalty, and it's still first down.
That's Mario Yaku, one of the more versatile offensive linemen here. Here he is right here. We talked about this front four for New Mexico. They're a pretty squirrely group. They've had some success getting after the passer, and right there, he just hangs on for dear life to Taylor Timmons, who had a half sack last week, got some hustle to him. Now it's Boise's turn to have some errors.
Cooper Castleberry is our referee tonight. It's surprising in its own right. We're over 5 minutes in and there's not a score. Madison slips across the 45-yard line to the 42. Donnie White Jr. on the stop.
Another conservative play call there by Boise. Initially, New Mexico did a nice job of corralling that and forcing the ball carrier back up inside, but this time the pursuit wasn't there. And that's one of the things I've noticed, Carter. They fly to the football, but every once in a while there's a breakdown. One guy gets out of his gap, and it's a home run.
On second and 13, play action, Rippon. Zips it complete. Wilson has it inside the 25-yard line. So Cedric Wilson becomes the target for Rippon. That one goes for 21. Crosby makes the stop.
Cedric Wilson's been one of the players that the coaches have been excited about, really coming on as a playmaker. He's got a pretty good arm, too. Threw a touchdown to McNichols earlier in the year. He's somebody to keep an eye on. Boise State, one of the best in the country at dialing up special slash trick plays. But once they get down here near the red zone, they like to feature the run. New Mexico's got to bow its back and expect heavy run here.
Out of the eye, Rippon under center. It's McNichols. Not much room. Maybe a yard, gets barely inside the 20-yard line of New Mexico. Ryan Santos, a strong safety, makes the stop. Tonight's red zone is brought to you by Verizon. And the big issue for Boise State, not so much this year's numbers, but Boise State last year versus New Mexico, One touchdown in six trips to the red zone against the Lobos.
Every time you kick a field goal and don't score a touchdown, you take 4 points off the scoreboard.
Pressure up the middle. Ripping. Almost picked inside the five. Daniel Henry had an interception in the red zone as Diavonzo put the pressure on Rippon.
Well, we talked about how active Nick Diavonzo is. Just good job of hustling. The miscommunication there, he virtually comes free. That's the exact sort of pressure we talked about. I got to say, this New Mexico defense is showing up ready to play here early, doing exactly what it is they wanted to do to start this game.
Bringing up third and nine from just inside the 20-yard line.
They're going to expect pressure. You have to watch screens, draws, or delays here and stay in your rush lanes.
Only one deep safety for the Lobos. There's a flag down. They did not get the playoff in time on third and nine.
Delay of game by number four of the offense. It's a 5-yard penalty, and it's still third down.
So you talk about missed opportunities. New Mexico had a chance at the red zone takeaway. And then now the penalty on Boise State's going to back them out to the 25. And it's a windy night. Field goals are not certain for either side with a gusty night in Albuquerque.
Great point, partner.
On third and 14 now. Rip into the post. And it's caught. Spurbeck has it for a first down. Thomas Spurbeck. The huge target in the passing game makes it first and goal Broncos.
There really seems to be a connection between these two. Thomas Spurbeck just running a nice bender route for the huge pickup on the first down. This is where you got to buckle down again. Boise likes run down here inside the 10-yard line. It's got to watch the tight ends as well.
First and goal. It's McNichols who gets the touch. Not much there. Ryan Santos, the strong safety, again on the stop. So Jeremy McNichols, 10 touchdowns. Second in the nation. Seven of those rushing touchdowns. But McNichols looks like he is headed to the sideline for second and goal.
He really has been the workhorse for this team on the ground. Had 30 carries a week ago and led the Broncos in receptions. You wonder how long a back of his size and stature can keep that up as he gets nicked up here early.
And now it's Demas in for the banged up McNichols. Rippon on second and goal. The fade to the end zone. Caught, touchdown. Cedric Wilson holds it in. The fourth catch of the drive by Cedric Wilson. And despite the stumbles, Boise State able to get in the end zone. 12 plays, 81 yards. Rippon to Wilson finishes it off.
This is just a simple fade route. We talked about the playmaking abilities of Wilson. Pushes off a little bit to create some separation, but a beautifully thrown ball and hands catch by Wilson, and it's a touchdown for the guys in white.
So Tyler Rossa on for the PAT. Rossa boots it through. Well, the last time these teams met in Albuquerque, 109 points on the board. We have our first seven tonight.
Jill went to Lowe's and got these stylish floors. They have all.
College football on CBS Sports Network is sponsored by Geico. 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance. By Ram Trucks, America's longest lasting pickups. And by Verizon. Join a better network because better matters.
Bright and early this morning, the 45th Balloon Fiesta here in Albuquerque, New Mexico. Jenny Dell and I had a nice little hike, and I think Jenny counted 90 hot air balloons up in the air once we reached our hiking destination. That'll be another touchback. New Mexico gets it at the 25-yard line. Tonight's Phillips 66 Athlete of the Week spotlight. The sophomore from San Diego, David Moa, the impactful nose tackle in the middle for Boise State.
Yeah, he's earned the nickname Moa Constrictor because of how well he's taken on that nose guard position. He's only 271 pounds, very undersized, but what that allows him is tremendous quickness. Already has 5.5 sacks, the most for a nose tackle and interior lineman for Boise since 2009.
Question about where this ball is going to be spotted rather than the hash. Going to take it out to midfield at the 25-yard line. Not sure why New Mexico was seeking to move it to the hash after the touchback, but here's Lamar Jordan, and here's another New Mexico penalty there, third.
It's going to be a false start, third New Mexico penalty.
A false start halfway. By number 77 of the offense. It's a 5-yard penalty, and it's still first down.
That's Charlie Grammel, left tackle, the redshirt freshman from Frisco, Texas, putting his team at a disadvantage behind the sticks already, and they haven't even taken a snap on this drive.
Lamar Jordan at quarterback, can place the injured Austin Apodaca. Jordan's going to keep it on the option keeper, back to the original line of scrimmage at 25. Vallejo there on the stop. Now we take a look at the New Mexico starting offense.
Yeah, this offensive line is big and powerful. They got big guards, but athletic centers and tackles. Reno Henderson is a younger player. He is a senior, but a first-time starter, and he's somebody that kind of showed up on tape. He plays with a chip on his shoulder. He's not afraid to trade punches in there. He's got to lead this offensive line that has to carry the load for New Mexico, that has to keep this game close tonight because they're not built to come back.
On second and 10, Jordan turns it upfield. He's going to be tackled at the 31-yard line by Chancellor James, giving us a chance to look at the Boise State defense.
Well, so many losses on the defensive line from a year ago. That was the concern, but Sam McCaskill's really helped to kind of alleviate some of those concerns. Had 5 tackles and 1.5 sacks a week ago. He's been a really active player that the New Mexico offensive staff told us they were concerned about him and several other of those guys in the front seven.
17 sacks, most in the nation. Broncos have gone up against a lot of passing teams. Now they get a run-heavy team tonight. Owens in the backfield on 3rd and 4. Jordan going to keep it again on the option. Has the first down as Jordan gets to the 38. Hartsfield there on the stop. It's the first down of the night for New Mexico.
This has to make the New Mexico offensive staff happy. They knew that Lamar Jordan had to carry a little bit more of the load in this game. They need him to step up and make some plays to take over. He's been playing a little bit conservative, but so far early on tonight, he's calling his own number, making the right reads, and moving the chains.
4 rushes, 13 yards for the junior from Frisco, Texas, Centennial High School. New Mexico gives a lot of different formations. This one works well. Owens is going to take it to the end zone. Touchdown, Lobos. 62 yards as Owens breaks it. A PAT away from tying it.
We just talked about the importance of that offensive line. That is parting of the White Sea in this case. Owens dropping that gear. We talked about the playmaking ability of Gibson, them needing to replace that. Well, Owens answers the call big time.
Second touchdown of his Lobo career. Sanders on for the PAT. Both teams went 3 and out on the opening possession. Boise State, a long touchdown drive to go up 7-0. And in just 4 plays, Tyrone Owens and the Lobos respond, even at 7 in Albuquerque.
I'm Jay.
Boise State's trouble defending the option continues. They gave up a 62-yard touchdown run.
Yeah, keep an eye on the backers right here. They split and each goes away from each other. You see 44 there. He has no idea what's going on. They were so concerned about the legs of Lamar Jordan that they ran themselves out of the play, and Darren Lee and Ben Weaver opened that up, and that offensive line for New Mexico got it done. And again, Carter, this is exactly what they need to do. Look at that. Boise State Broncos averaged 72 rush yards allowed coming into this game. New Mexico just eclipsed that on that last drive.
Boise State is yet to allow a 100-yard rushing team. Now, again, they've gone up against a lot of heavy passing teams, but nonetheless. Oh, and speaking of passes, did you see that one last week? The Hail Mary to keep Tennessee undefeated, and now the top 10 matchup, the Home Depot SEC on CBS tomorrow, 3:30 Eastern, beginning with the Auto Trader College Football Today for that top 10 matchup after Tennessee's statement win last week.
It was a statement win, all right, but I'll say that Georgia did more to lose that game than Tennessee arguably did to win it. The game that really stood out to me is Washington over Stanford. I felt like they came out and really made a statement, and I think the torch is passed in the Pac-12 conference.
Rippon zips it complete. Anderson makes the grab. Oh, yeah, Chris Peterson now with Washington doing a nice job. A former Bronco head coach.
And they're built exactly the same.
Okay.
Physical on the offensive and defensive lines. Great skill and speed on the perimeter. I think Boise's going to have to throw the ball. They like their one-on-one matchups. New Mexico's pretty much declared, we're not going to let you run. So Rippon's arm's going to have to let it rip.
On second and two, there's McNichols. And again, selling out on the run. But McNichols takes the pop, keeps rolling, gets to the 40. A chance for us to check in with Jenny.
An update with Lobos cornerback Isaiah Brown. He was helped off the field earlier. The athletic trainers put him, taped up his left ankle. And he tried to put a little bit of weight on it. It did not go well, guys. He looked like to be in intense pain. And as you can see right there, he was carted off the field heading to the locker room.
Thank you, Jenny. And now another Lobo is down on the field. Yep. Waiting to confirm that that's who we think it is. But it would be, yep, it's another significant one for New Mexico. Diavonzo, the defensive end, needing more help from the trainers.
A well-put-together man is said to be sharp at GMC.
Last 2 years have been wild between the Broncos and Lobos. 7-7 start here in the first quarter. And good injury news for New Mexico. Nick Diavonzo goes down on this play, and he was hobbling to the sideline when he went to commercial. Appears to be okay, and you see Bob Davey coach him up, get him ready to get back in there in a moment.
I wonder if safety Daniel Henry blew him up on that.
McNichols short gain, and that's Okonkwo at defensive end who makes the stop.
This Boise State offensive line is coached by Scott Huff, who's their co-offensive coordinator, was elevated recently. Been really impressed over the years with how well these guys come off the football. But tonight, so far, it's the Lobos that have had the advantage.
I think there was some motion on that one.
Foolish penalties kill you. The thing that's hard, man.
Offside with contact by number 53 of the defense. It's a 5-yard penalty, and it's still second down.
Fourth on New Mexico.
They're shooting themselves in the foot. They can't afford to do it. They told us coming into this game that their margin for error was so small. Now you're second and short. Boise State's entire playbook is wide open as a result of that penalty.
Second and three, one deep safety. So they're coming after him. Rippon takes the deep shot. And it's Wilson who hauls it in. Cedric Wilson makes the grab. And he is in for the touchdown. Second touchdown grab for Wilson. This one goes for 54. Rippon saw the pressure coming. Dialed up the deep shot for Cedric Wilson. And it's right over top of the freshman corner, Lilly.
Elijah Lilly once again on one-on-one coverage, getting smoked by Cedric Wilson, who's a savvy route runner, once again creating separation once the ball's in the air. And Lilly's just overmatched and gives up another quick score on the outside.
So Isaiah Brown goes down with the injury on the opening possession. The freshman Lilly forced to go in at corner, and it has been Rippon to Wilson. over Lilly for both touchdowns, and Boise State has the 14-7 lead on New Mexico.
This is just a straight go route. Locked up in man-on-man coverage on the outside, one-on-one. You see Lilly's got inside body presses, trying to use the sideline as a defender. But Wilson sticks that right hand out there to create some separation, and a beautifully thrown deep ball by Brett Rippon is on the money to give Boise a seven-point lead.
That's obviously a tough spot for the true freshman, Elijah Lilly. You're forced into action because of the injury. You got to go up against a beast, 6'3", 183, Cedric Wilson. But credit Boise State for finding that matchup and going to it twice now for touchdowns.
And what that's going to do is it's going to force defensive coordinator Kevin Cosgrove to go to a two-high look, some sort of zone, because he's just overmatched out there on the edge one-on-one. Tough position for a young kid to be out there against a high-quality football player. That's his job to do.
You saw Bob Davey try to give him some encouragement after the second touchdown allowed. Short kick be taken inside the 10. That's Chestnut hurdling his way to the 21-yard line. Sunday, 6 Eastern, the world's top riders take the stage in Idaho at the PBR Built Ford Tough Series DeWalt FlexBolt Invitational right here on CBS Sports Network, a 24-hour home of CBS Sports. Eighth meeting between New Mexico and Boise State. The only win for the Lobos was that unlikely win last year on the blue turf. Bronco fans making their way to New Mexico for the weekend to root on the 4-0 Boise State Broncos. Owens and McCorley in the backfield with Lamar Jordan. It'll be McCorley who takes it and goes rumbling for a gain of it. At least 13. That's the junior who had three touchdowns and the win over San Jose State last week.
Yeah, he's 5'11", 218 pounds, a little bit more of a physical runner, but a really nice job that time up front at along the line of scrimmage, creating some seams, and McCorley does the rest. Boise getting gashed more so than they have been all year long on the ground tonight.
7 touchdowns on the year for the junior from Meridian, Mississippi. This will be a toss to Chestnut. That's the junior from Miami via Coffeyville Junior College. And so you talked about with Terry Gibson, who had the big numbers, out with the hamstring injury. New Mexico runs running back by committee anyway, so you didn't think it was going to be a huge factor.
Well, not necessarily from an experience standpoint. You certainly miss his explosiveness. I mean, my goodness, the kid was leading the country with 13 yards per carry. He was a home run hitter right out of the gate. But so far, we've seen Tyrone Owens step up and carry some of that load. So it's still a big deal, but significantly lessened because of the style of this offense.
Touchdown drive last time New Mexico had it. Jordan pulls it. Room to run on the edge. Jordan now is going to toss it. That's a loose football, and Boise State appears to have it. James appears to grab it. On a terrible decision by Lamar Jordan, a fumble, and Chancellor James recovers it.
Winning the turnover battle was a key for New Mexico coming
into
tonight.
The ruling on the field is a backward pass, incomplete, and recovered by the defense. First down.
You hit the nail on the head, partner. This is just a bad decision. He's trying to make something. First of all, he's carrying the football in his wrong hand. And had he put it in the proper hand, which is the outside, he wouldn't even thought of throwing it there. Just another miscue for the Lobos early on here in the first quarter. Great job by Tanner Vallejo. Playing that ball extremely well. That's a huge, huge turnover and a great play by the Broncos.
The previous play is under further review.
So the ruling on the field, backwards pass, which is essentially means fumble. There's a few fine points between the difference between a backward pass and a fumble, but it's a live ball. So that would be, you would have to determine that the ball is a forward pass at the point that Vallejo knocks it in the air. That is going to be a very difficult one for Rich Collin, our replay official, to overturn.
Certainly is going to be. Here's a really good look at it here.
I mean, the ball barely traveled before Vallejo got a hand on it.
It's all over it.
Right.
It's a heads-up play there by Chancellor James to come up on that football.
You saw the headlines when they're at the right on top of it, and he makes the signal immediately. Backwards pass, live football recovered by Boise State.
It almost looked like he was trying to throw the football forward, like he lost track of where he was on the field, maybe thinking he was behind the line of scrimmage. In which case, that would be a really poorly designed, really drawn out run pass option. But because he was beyond the line of scrimmage, just a poor decision all the way around.
I mean, even if you rule that a forward pass, it's an illegal forward pass. It's beyond the line of scrimmage. And again, this is our replay booth. And unlike a lot of sports, this isn't going back to headquarters. This is Rich Collin and the replay official who makes the call. And Cooper Castleberry, our referee, will deliver the verdict.
This might be an illegal forward pass, Carter. They're really discussing this. It's important these officials work hard. They want to get it right. But I'm wondering if Lamar Jordan was trying to throw that football, which would make it an illegal pass. Which I'm pretty sure would negate the turnover.
And oh, by the way, the rule book says there is no time limit on reviews. If you hadn't figured that out watching college football.
How was your hike today?
It was lovely. Really was. Into the foothills. Again, Jenny counted 90 balloons from the 45th annual balloon fiesta.
Here's the call.
After further review, the pass was forward from the 41-yard line. It was an illegal forward pass because the passer was beyond the line. It's a loss of down. It will be third down.
I'm surprised by that just because it was just such a question mark as to whether that was forward or backward.
Well, they spent their time on it. And regardless of whether or not you agree with it, it looked to me like he was trying to throw the football forward, which is still a poor decision to your point, but one that's not nearly as costly as it was when it was immediately called on the field as a fumble.
So instead of a turnover, it's just the penalty, and they still got to figure out how we're going to step this one off. And the discussion now on the Boise State sideline is with Brian Harsin trying to explain why that was a forward pass and not a backward pass, therefore loose ball recovered by Boise State. But for now, you wipe out the takeaway.
And you also wipe out a pretty good run that would have given a short field to be able to convert here on third down.
From the spot of the illegal forward pass, the penalty assessed, bring it back to third. And I don't think they may have the down and distance correct after the penalty. There is still plenty of discussion about down and distance. They have not yet marked off the penalty yards.
Carter, the last play was second and eight from the 37-yard line.
So incomplete, illegal forward pass. Brian Harsin is still arguing about this. Wasn't there a penalty assessed? If you call that an elite,
yeah. I don't think they've gotten this right.
They
lost the down, but not the yardage.
Lamar Jordan, that pass is complete to Gamblin as Hartsfield makes the stop. So just to tidy that up, if it's a forward pass, it's an illegal forward pass because he's well beyond the line of scrimmage. So it's not just a loss of down. Then you had to have the penalty yardage for the illegal forward pass, which was never assessed. If we can get further clarification on that, we'll give you further clarification on that. But Boise State gets the stop. And Bohorquez will punt it away. And here is a penalty flag, false start on New Mexico. That's their fifth.
A false start by number 27 of the offense. It's a 5-yard penalty, and it's still fourth down.
This isn't a very disciplined football team, Carter. They struggled with penalties a year ago in this game. They've struggled so far this year. They negated another drive, shooting themselves in the foot, and they just can't seem to get out of their own way. Boise State's too good of a football team to not bring your best.
Bohorquez, short punt, out of bounds near the 40-yard line. So Boise State and Cedric Wilson get the football back. Short punt. Wilson, two touchdowns already.
Yeah, he's just a force out in the open field. We saw his ability to use his body. Brett Rippon certainly liking what he sees in his receiver, been a favorite target. You give one-on-one matchups to a big, fast, speedy receiver against a freshman, bad things are going to happen. But to Boise State's credit, they've been able to capitalize on those opportunities, which is exactly what you need to do when you're on the road. The Broncos seem to be much more composed here at the end of the first quarter than the home team.
Three and out the first time Boise State had it. Touchdowns on the last two possessions. McNichols up the middle. Dakota Cox there for the stop. The senior man in the middle who's already earned his finance degree, and he has earned a lot in his New Mexico career. Coming into this game, 333 career tackles. Second most among active players, and nine tackles a game. He missed the Rutgers game in concussion protocol, but Dakota Cox has had a great career in the middle for New Mexico.
Yeah, he's a quintessential box player. I love his take-on skills. He shocks and sheds the offensive lineman, throws him to the side, and makes tackle after tackle.
Rippon. Time to throw, but nobody open downfield. So Rippon just tucks it, gets back to near the 50. That's going to bring up third down with Nick Diavonzo again putting the pressure. So Diavonzo, who went out banged up earlier, back there making his presence known.
That's exactly what New Mexico has to do, is try and pressure Rippon. When he gets back there and sets his feet, he's wide open. I would expect pressure here, but let's see how defensive coordinator Kevin Cosgrove decides to defend this, putting a safety over the top to the receivers. To the top right of your screen.
Rippon on third and nine. Look in that direction. Complete. Spurbeck has it for a first down. With Lee Crosby there defending. Spurbeck, who had 20 catches a year ago against New Mexico.
That's just tremendous arm strength on the out route from the far right hash. Saw these guys down on the field warming up. Brett Rippon really has great accuracy throwing those routes, and Spurbeck seems to be his favorite target there from the slot.
So that is the end of the first quarter. Two touchdown grabs by Cedric Wilson from Brett Rippon, and it's 14-7. You're watching College Football on CBS Sports Network, presented by Geico. Breast Cancer Awareness Month. You see the pink CBS Sports on our I-bar. First play of the second quarter is a handoff to Jeremy McNichols. Donnie White Jr. there on the stop. Short gain. The Mexico's done a good job against the Boise State run game.
And they're winning up front. They're winning their one-on-one matchups. Boise State only 20 rushing yards through one quarter of play.
Hurry up on second down. Rippon to the air. Zips it to the outside. Spurbeck has his third grab. That one goes for a first down inside the Lobo 30.
That short controlled passing game is what Boise's answer is to that tough run defense by the Lobos.
Hurry up. Spurbeck again. Back-to-back grabs by Spurbeck. This time he goes rolling inside the 20-yard line. Lee Crosby on the stop. Spurbeck slow getting up after his second straight catch. There is a flag down.
A personal foul, tripping by number five of the defense. The penalty's half the distance to the goal, and it's first down.
The seventh penalty already against New Mexico.
Seven penalties.
That's the count, huh?
Oh, my gosh.
We're racking them up. This is a rarely called one. But you can see why it was called on Crosby.
Yeah, Chaz Addison had a nice chop block there as well. Guys are hustling downfield.
Rippin to the end zone. Incomplete. Intended for Wilson again. Looking for his third touchdown grab. The junior from Memphis's White Station High School, Cedric Wilson.
Credit the pressure that time by number 47, Austin Ocasio. Had a pick six at the end of the third quarter that sealed the victory a week ago, and that pressure that time saved a touchdown for his defensive unit.
Boise State touchdown last time they were in the red zone inside the New Mexico 20. That was one of the big issues last year in their loss to the Lobos. Handing off, that's McNichols, straight ahead, touchdown! Boise State, McNichols is in, his first rushing touchdown. The 17th straight game with a touchdown for Jeremy McNichols.
Just a tremendous job up front. As much as Boise State had gotten pushed around prior to that, that was an outstanding job of coming off the football, resetting the line of scrimmage, creating some tremendous rush lanes from Jeremy McNichol. Really nice job by the Big Uglies up front getting it done.
11 touchdowns now for Jeremy McNichols. He's playing on a Friday night. He's tied for second in the nation with this touchdown. They want to take another look at it. He's in. That's a touchdown. And that means he's going to have second place all alone for a while with his 11th touchdown. Only Lamar Jackson of Louisville has more touchdowns. It is now officially a touchdown in the books. Eighth rushing touchdown of the year for the junior from Long Beach. Ross's PAT makes it 21-7. Rippon started 1-for-4. He's gone 9-for-11 since. And in the red zone, give it to number 13, McNichols, for the 11th time this year into the end zone. Boise State still hasn't trailed this year, up 21-7 on New Mexico.
Here's a look at that touchdown. You see the backers are mugged up here. This is just going to be a simple inside zone. But this offensive line, which returned four starters, look at this hole right inside there. Excellent job by Steven Baggett, Mario Yaku, Travis Averill, Archie Lewis, and John Mulchin. Doing a good job of taking care of business up front, Carter. I've been in games like this where you can't get anything going, but you stick with the run game. You finally find your rhythm. The Broncos did exactly that, and offensive line coach Scott Huff is going to be very happy with what he saw on that play from his unit.
Ross's kickoff. Chestnut's going to bring it out. Chestnut would have had the football at the 25-yard line. He brings it out, and he is popped at the 14. Tomorrow on CBS Sports Network, full day of football, including 6th-ranked Houston at Navy. That game at 3 o'clock Eastern time tomorrow on the 24-hour home of CBS Sports. And two really good teams in the MAC go at it, Northern Illinois and Western Michigan, 6:30 Eastern, presented by GEICO. Houston, Western Michigan, Boise State, and Air Force, the undefeated teams from the Group of Five conferences, still undefeated. Two of those in the Mountain West with Boise State and Air Force.
Houston taking on Navy, going to have a couple extra days of playing Thursday night prior to get ready for that triple option attack.
There's an injured player on the kickoff for Boise State, Tyson Maeva, the freshman linebacker who started this game because Joe Martirano is down. So Maeva on the kickoff needs help going back to the Boise State sideline.
He was down low to the ground, threw his shoulder in there, and that seemed to be what he was holding on to when he came up. That was quite a collision there, and you made a great point, Carter. Why take the football out of the end zone when you could have the ball spotted at the 25-yard line? I get that you're wanting to make something happen, but it's just been a series of poor decisions and foolish penalties by New Mexico. It's really negated some pretty good individual efforts across the board on both sides of the football.
It's a difference of 11 yards. Lamar Jordan, a junior from Frisco, Texas, at quarterback. There's a toss. Owens on the edge. He has the corner. Turns it across the 20-yard line and knocked out of bounds by Raymond Ford. Big hit. But that run by Owens is going to push New Mexico over 100 rushing yards. First time Boise State has allowed a 100-yard rushing team.
Carter, this is a big drive for New Mexico as we see this big pop there. There's no doubt about whether or not Boise can run to the football. But by being down 14 points, this Lobo offense isn't built to come back. I think it's pretty important here in this ballgame that they get some sort of points here on the board, because Boise State offensively seems to have found their groove.
Jordan gonna keep it and slip a couple tackles. Here goes Lamar Jordan with a block on the edge, rolling inside the 50-yard line. Ford finally shoves him out.
I think Tanner Vallejo might have been hurt on that play. He was one of the guys that missed the tackles there. Just some over pursuit. This is that triple option that's so hard to defend, but you get that one-on-one option. Just some really nice open field running that time by Jordan. Gets them across the 50.
And Vallejo back on the Boise State sideline. The senior linebacker leader of the Boise State defense.
Especially when we saw Maeva go out a couple plays before.
Jordan's going to hand off to McCorley. He is shoved back. We'll see where the forward progress was stopped. But McCaskill and Frazier, the two ends, and call it a gain of one. That's a big concern for Vallejo, who missed the Utah State game. Now, Boise State doesn't release any injury information, so we won't know about Vallejo. Don't even know the specifics of why he missed the last game against Utah State, but bottom line, he's on the sideline. As is Martirano, as is Maeva. That's the three primary linebackers all out of the game right now for Boise State.
Ben Weaver and Darren Lee are still in the game, though. Those guys are pretty good ball players.
Jordan, that's a backwards pass. That's a live football. And Woodhouse able to get on top of it. But it's going
to
be
on the field is a backward pass recovered by the offense. Third down.
This is just a swing pass and shows you some of the limitations of Lamar Jordan throwing the football. Sometimes those short swing passes that take touch are the hardest for quarterbacks. With another potentially costly turnover when the ball hit in the ground by the Lobos.
Good news for Boise State. Tanner Vallejo back out there.
Put a couple near misses when Lamar Jordan's tried to throw the football tonight.
Third and 18. Jordan on the roll. Pressured. He's forced to throw it, and it's incomplete. Almost picked on the edge. It was Gauci, the tight end, the intended receiver. Chancellor James, the safety, had a chance at the interception. And here's where we might remind you that Jordan is playing every snap because Apodaca, the senior quarterback who throws it more, is out with a collarbone injury.
And that really limits this offense. One of the things that Apodaca brought to the table was the ability to throw forward passes and keep defenses honest. With Lamar Jordan back there, Boise's able to load that box. They hadn't been able to stop the run, but this last series, they finally seem to have found the secret inside to be able to get some stops combined with the Lobos' miscues.
Bojorquez punting with the wind. Butler will let it bounce inside the 15, inside the 10, and New Mexico downs it at the 6-yard line. So Bohorquez able to pin Boise State back. They lead by 14.
Welcome back. The Broncos are up 21-7. And last year, when New Mexico beat the Broncos on blue turf, the Broncos actually tied up the game. They almost did on a crazy last-second play, but it was New Mexico's Markell Bird who made a crazy stop to preserve the win. Tragically, the 20-year-old passed away in a car accident after the Lobos bowl game in December. In Bird's honor, New Mexico has placed a special marker on the 22-yard line at the stadium. Guys, they also have glassed over his locker. You see the 22 right there. They've glassed over his locker, complete with his helmet and his jersey, and the entire team is wearing a decal of Markell on their helmets. Dakota Cox told me that the Lobos are always playing for Bird, but today against Boise, it's even more prevalent.
I thought it was a really nice gesture that a lot of the Boise State players, when they came out for warm-ups, went to the 22, touched the 22, took pictures at that 22. And it was an especially tough week for New Mexico when you think about that win and what Markell Bird, and the play that he made. And that was, you know, we got to talk to the Lobos yesterday, and it's still very, very much on the surface for those young men.
Offside by number 95 of the defense. It's a 5-yard penalty, and it's still first down.
So this was Lamar Jordan pregame. I mean, coming out in that 22 for the teammate of Markell Bird, and now the starting quarterback for New Mexico. It's part of the, and I don't have time to get into all of it right now, but this New Mexico football team has been through numerous tragedies since they have been together. And a lot of those things, talk to the players, you talk to the coaches, and they say, hey, that's one of the reasons why you're a team. Is when very, very difficult things happen, you rely on one another. It's not just about the football team, football game. It's about those moments in life.
No question. We've seen some tremendous examples of sportsmanship all throughout college football this year with very similar circumstances.
So meanwhile, in the game, Rippon on 2nd and 5 fires incomplete to bring up 3rd down for Boise State, and a chance for field position for New Mexico.
This is a huge 3rd down play. Remember, it's important for the Lobos to keep this close because they're not built to come back. So this is a 3rd down, to your point, Carter, about field position. If they can get themselves off the field here and get the ball back to an offense that's found some heat running, they could get back in this ballgame.
Rippon steps up and delivers to Cedric Wilson across the 30. Sheds a tackler at the 35, and Wilson takes it all the way across the 45-yard line. A 35-yard gain for Wilson.
Just Cedric Wilson here at the bottom of your screen, just going to run a straight dig route coming back inside. What allowed that play to go, Carter, was absolutely zero pressure on Brett Rippon, who set his feet, let the ball rip, and then a couple poor missed tackles right there. Some nice running by Cedric Wilson, and Boise State sits just shy of midfield.
Boise State has now converted on 3rd and 8. 3rd and 13. That one's 3rd and 5. Wilson a little hobbled after making another grab. He's already gone over 100 receiving yards. 132 receiving yards early in the second quarter for Wilson. Ripping up 1st and 10. Takes another deep shot. Spurbeck hauls it in. Touchdown, Boise State. Ripping to Spurbeck. That one goes 54 yards, and in 2 huge pass plays, Boise State is into the end zone to make it 27-7. The last 2 pass plays go for 89 yards to Wilson and Spurbeck.
We talked about the balance of this offense at the top of the show. Boise State, after starting with a 3-and-out, have scored 4 straight touchdowns on their ensuing drives. That's what balanced offense gets you.
Rossa boots it through. A 28-7 lead on New Mexico. We told you it's been wild the last couple of years between the Broncos and Lobos. If New Mexico is going to get back in this one, they're going to have to turn it into an especially wild night in Albuquerque. It's 28-7 Broncos. You? Remember how two plays ago we were talking about New Mexico had a chance to get field position? And then 89 yards in two plays, including the TD.
And then this happens. Just going to be a slant and go and some poor technique by Ryan Santos, the safety. One of the things that Spurbuck does the best, man, he's a crisp route runner, just completely turns Santos around. And again, no pressure on Rippon. The young sophomore dropping balls, and take a look at that. Spurbeck, third all-time in career receiving yards in Boise State history, a school that has a ton of good wide receivers.
Yes, indeed. That will be a touchback. So New Mexico will take it at the 25, now down by three touchdowns. Let's take a look at the Nissan Heisman Watch.
Well, let's just go ahead and say this. It's Lamar Jackson's to lose at this point, even with that loss against Clemson. He's just had an outstanding season, electric playmaker. But very quietly, JT Barrett is having a tremendous year as well. Ohio State has some big games coming up. He'll get a chance to prove it. And I put Derek Barnett on there because he's a difference maker. We talked about Tennessee earlier. At the end of the game, when he needed to make a play, his defense needed to make a play, he found a way to do so. And that's why he's on there, I think, as one of the most outstanding players this year.
Jordan throws it deep, and that is incomplete. Later on tonight, the guys in New York will get you up to date on leading Heisman contenders and weigh in on who they think will take home the sport's most coveted trophy.
Missed opportunities there again, Carter. The limitations of Lamar Jordan's arm. Wide open receivers running down the field. Emmanuel Harris in this case. That could have been a touchdown, but the ball was off target. Bob Davey cannot be happy with what he's seen from his unit that started this game off red hot.
I think that's accurate. They're throwing into the wind right now, too. So almost one-dimensional at this point. And Jordan wrapped up, dropped for a loss. Whitlock makes the stop. Now we check in with Brent in New York.
Carter, you mentioned Clemson, that win over Louisville. No hangover tonight on the road against Boston College. Touchdown run in the fourth quarter. They lead 42-10, guys.
Yeah, that's getting it done.
Yep, that's taking care of business, and that's what good teams do. And that's what I think we're watching Boise State do here tonight. We talked to Brian Harsin yesterday at their hotel, and he said the thing that he's happiest about his team is that they haven't folded.
Jordan scrambling, throws it, fourth down.
But when I asked him, what's the thing that keeps you up at night, the thing you want to see more from your guys, he said, putting the dagger in teams. We haven't been able to put teams away. Tonight, Carter, so far in this game, with the second quarter just underway, they've done that. We talked about at the top of the show that style points matter. Boise State has come on the road after a little bit of a rocky start. Didn't panic, have been executing. And are taking control of this game.
Sam Gentry has come into the game to punt for New Mexico. So instead of Bohorquez, it is Gentry. He gets it away into the wind. It's going to bounce. It's Cedric Wilson, who fields it for Boise State. 28-7 Broncos on the Lobos. Sophomore QB for Boise State has three touchdown passes, and he is completing 67%.
Well, at the top of the show, we talked about Brett Rippon, and if you give him time, he kind of picked off where he left off a year ago. He's been money tonight, a little bit of a slow start, but since then, really been doing a nice job with some downfield touch, throwing the vertical ball. Cedric Wilson being one of his go-to targets. Then he finds his go-to guy, Thomas Spurbeck, for a touchdown. Take a look at his numbers tonight. 12 for 18, 243, three touchdowns. Most importantly, no interceptions.
12 for 18.
67%.
Zips that one to the outside. Anderson, boy, he nearly got free. Martin makes a shoestring tackle, or Anderson could have been down the sideline.
Early on, this was Boise State's approach. They wanted to get the ball out into the perimeter with their playmakers, but there were a couple face mask penalties, but that time some nice open field tackling by Martin.
94-yard drive in a hurry. Last time Boise State had it, that's the longest drive this year. A big missed opportunity for New Mexico. Low snap, bobble, loose. Rippon appears to be on top of it. Rippon and Neas Martin, the corner, fighting for the football, but looks like Rippon has it.
Credit Kimmy Carson with the missed snap there with a center. When you got pressure right over the top of you, you can get a little bit panicked, and I think that's what happened to Stephen Baggett. Really nice timing there by the weak side linebacker, Kimmy Carson, number two, to force the errant snap.
Bring the Broncos back to third and nine. Lobos show pressure up the middle. Rippon zips it complete. Spurbeck again beating the blitz again. Spurbeck takes it inside the 25-yard line. Santos makes the stop. This one goes for 32 to Spurbeck.
See Rippon throwing the ball. Spurbeck just another great catch. The thing I love about 82, Carter, is his catch radius. You throw it anywhere near that cat, he's going to come down with the football. Just a tremendous pair of soft hands. Breaking ankles, turning DBs around. But
Spurbeck is down on the Boise State sideline for now. Limping coming away after that 32-yard grab. Santos out of the game as well. In the secondary for New Mexico. So Gurgle is in. McNichols takes the handoff. Wrestled down. He is Martin. He is a tough tackling corner.
He is. He's kind of somebody that the coaches told us just basically transferred, came in off the street, and became a starter. They didn't really expect much from Martin, but he's really ended up being a nice player for him. You always like a good corner that can come up and tackle. Now he's a little high. You're taking on a player of Jeremy McNichols' stature, you might want to go a little bit lower there, but nonetheless, good job getting him down.
Second and seven from the 20. Rippon flings it complete. Wilson shaking his way inside the 10. Wilson still on his feet as he's finally brought down at the 5 to bring up first and goal for Boise State. Parker and Santos on the stop.
New Mexico just doesn't seem to have any answers on the outside edge with the speed and skill that Boise State is bringing. And Rippon, again, uncontested. He's putting the ball on the money, overrunning. They are running to the football, getting some pursuit, but here they are now on the 5-yard line. Watch the legs of 13.
Four tight ends shift in for first and goal. I'll hand it off to McNichols, and he is driven back. Crosby leads the way, along with Martin. Forward progress stopped at the 8.
Penetration on the right side of that offensive line, and some good aggressive downhill running by the secondary. You see 12, Ryan Santos getting in there. A lot of DBs filling in those gaps and run support. I wouldn't be surprised if Boise State goes to play action, but it looks like they're going to talk about it here before they do.
Boise State calls their first timeout of the half. 30-second timeout.
Boise State, two trips to the red zone. They have touchdowns in both. Now you have second and goal, and no question that when you have McNichols in the game, who has 11 touchdowns, second most in the FBS, you have to start with number 13.
And that's exactly what New Mexico's doing, and that's why they got 3 lost yards on that last play. But when you're so aggressive with your secondary, and when you're so multiple offensively for Boise State, I think this is a beautiful situation if you're a play caller for the Broncos to get those big tight ends involved and some play action and maybe roll Rippon out to give him a two-way go on the outside edge.
Now, McNichols has had huge halves. He started hot against Oregon State, 146 yards in the first half. He closed strong in the last game against Utah State. He was kind of feeding McNichols down the stretch, run the football, run the clock. So even though there's only 21 rush yards up there for him so far, he's capable still putting up big numbers. On second and goal, Rippon drops, toss, Wilson again! Touchdown again! Cedric Wilson. Third touchdown grab of the night. Number one for Boise State is carrying the load in the first half.
That time he was working on Bijan Parker, number 27. He's got control of the football. 1 foot down, 2 foot down, almost a third knee down. What the officials are looking for, possession of the football, which clearly I think he has right there, 1 foot, 2 foot. I think that would have been a touchdown in the NFL.
Yep, Russell boots it through. 35-7, so a statement from Boise State. New Mexico won on their field last year. The Broncos rolling into Albuquerque. And even though this is a Boise State team that hasn't trailed yet this year, there are questions, hey, can Boise State play four quarters? Well, I think Cedric Wilson and the Broncos are providing a pretty strong statement here against the Lobos, just dominating, including Wilson.
This is what you want to do when you come on the road to play a complete game. And that's the very thing that Coach Harsin again told us yesterday. We need to learn to finish games. We haven't done that. We've let opponents stick around too much this year. And when you do that, the cost is you don't get your backups meaningful reps. You're not allowed to build depth. So with tonight's ability and with the way that Boise State has come out, up 28 points here in the second quarter, my guess is that the Broncos are going to get a chance to build that depth and take a step forward. Their goal to get to a New Year's Six bowl game as well.
Rossa kickoff. Chestnut will take a knee this time. Cedric Wilson had two receiving touchdowns this year, has three in the first half. Here's a guy out of Memphis's White Station High School, dual threat quarterback. His dad, Cedric, played at Tennessee 7 years at 7 years in the NFL. But Cedric, I mean, a physical specimen. Had to go to Coffeyville Community College and then to Boise State. So he is a guy who is emerging right now as one of those next huge threats for the Broncos, and this is his career night for Boise State.
Only two catches a week ago, but he's getting right tonight against this Lobos defense.
Gamblin goes in motion. The handoff goes to Chestnut straight ahead, and this is exactly where New Mexico couldn't be in this football game.
This was the very thing that they were trying to avoid. You're spot on there. This offense just isn't built to be able to come back. It's built upon ball possession, good defenses, trying to be able to steal and limit possessions of your opponent, a lot like we see out of Air Force and Navy and any of the teams that are options based. But we've seen several times tonight the limitation of Lamar Jordan's ability to throw the football has really hurt this offensive team.
Only one completed pass for New Mexico in the game. Jordan tucking it, running, gives a stiff arm, shakes his way across the 40, across the 50 for Lamar Jordan. So the strength with the legs for Lamar Jordan. 24-yard gain.
This is the thing that he does so well. He just runs and has so much speed, but a great stiff arm there and breaks the tackle. He's called and dialed up his number a lot tonight. Boise State was in position to make the tackle there, but just couldn't find a way to get it done.
Diamond formation in the backfield. Give it to Woodhouse straight ahead. And a chance for us to check with Jenny.
Yeah, an update on Thomas Spurbeck. He actually took his left shoe off, walked over to the training table, and they were checking out that left ankle. But, guys, he said, I'm good. Keep an eye on him, though. He is limping around the sideline right now.
Now, the question in a game that's 35-7, and now you're winding towards the second half, how much do you try and stretch one of your big offensive weapons in Spurbeck?
Well, you don't. You hope your defense gets a stop and you get to play some of those young guys that we talked about a couple seconds ago.
Jordan hands off again. McCauley straight ahead. Darren Lee there on the stop. He's playing a lot more snaps because of the injury to Joe Martirano. Leighton Vander Esch was also the scratch. So Boise State really thin linebacker depth going up against the option offense, but only seven on the board for New Mexico.
This is an offense that's a spread pistol triple option style offense, but you watch their offensive lineman up front. That last play was just simple zone blocking, getting a hat on the hat, moving the point of attack at the line of scrimmage.
The football's in there somewhere. Woodhouse has it. Boise State thinks they've taken it away. McCaskill ends up with the football. And they're going to say that Woodhouse is down.
The ruling on the field was forward progress prior to the ball coming out. Second down.
There was an awkward exchange that time between the quarterback and running back. That mesh is so important in triple option, the communication between the guy that's got the ball and the guy that could potentially take the ball. They usually use pressure to indicate whether you should take it or let it go. And that time they just weren't on the same page.
Jordan to throw, but first.
Oh, nice catch. But it won't count.
I don't see a flag, but
a false start by the offense number two. The whole team did never became set. It's a 5-yard penalty, and it's second down.
It's Damian Gamblin, wide receiver. And another self-inflicted wound for the guys in red.
That is 9 penalties, 68 yards in the first half. That is an ugly number.
But more than that, with your inability to throw the football, you're now second and 20. One hopping them on out routes.
Make it third and 17.
So it essentially negates the drive.
Right.
When you're this type of offense, you have a penalty like that. You just don't leave yourself that many options. This to me just isn't a very disciplined football team. And when you're built the way that New Mexico is, and you're playing against a team like Boise, your margin for error is so minimal. And the Lobos, unfortunately, just have been blowing through that all night. After a good start.
Jordan on third and 17 takes the sack. McCaskill, the 18th sack of the year by the Boise State defense, the most in the nation.
This
Boise
young
State
man
calls their second time out of the half.
Is so active on this right side of the offensive line, working on Garrett Adcock. Just collapses him. Adcock doesn't set the edge there. No punch. There's some pressure coming around with the linebackers, and it was 1-2-3 meet at the quarterback, and McCaskill doing what he's done so well all year long for his 5th sack of the year. All started with the penalty by Damian Gamblin putting him in that situation.
Boise State called a timeout. I mean, 2:59 left in the half.
Get a couple more touchdowns.
Sure, that's right. That's time for 2 more. That's 2-for-1 is usually a basketball term, but this might be a 2-for-1 opportunity for the Broncos at 2:59. It is Sam Gentry on DuPont again for New Mexico, and Cedric Wilson is back again. Almost got it. Wilson approaches it at the 25. Apparently called for a fair catch somewhere in there, so Wilson grabs it. Coming up on the Verizon Halftime Report, we'll send you to Brent Houston Christian and Jimmy Clausen in New York with an update on everything going on around college football, including all of the shifting of the games in Florida this weekend. That's all coming up on the Verizon Halftime Reports. Carter Blackburn, Aaron Taylor, Jenny Dell here in Albuquerque, New Mexico, where Boise State has accomplished its mission in the first half. Dominant against the Lobos.
The game clock to 2:55. 2:55.
Look at the numbers just for Spurbeck and Wilson. I mean, that's ridiculous in a game, and that's in the first half. And now back to McNichols across the 30-yard line.
This has been a defense that has been dominant at the point of attack. Boise just gassed them there. This is where you, if you're a Lobo player, you really got to check yourself and your pride and not give up with the game's score is a little bit lopsided.
Yeah, Spur back in the game, and we were ready to shut him down, but Spurbeck was not there yet.
No, this is a big deal for Boise to come out and play this well in the first half and be decisive about it. It's a road game. They are undefeated. We talked about at the open of the show that style points matter. But this is about them executing at a high level. And their run game was stopped early, but they've done a remarkable job finding their weapons and taking advantage in the pass game.
Spurbeck again. Back-to-back completions. New Mexico still can't bring him down. He'll take it to the 41. Henry finally makes the stop.
That time they brought a safety over the top of number one, Cedric Wilson. And Spurbeck in the slot just breaks inside. There was nobody within 15 yards of him. Boise State passing the ball at will.
17-yard gain. Low snap. Rippon picks it up. Busted play. He's going to dump it to the sideline, incomplete. Back to that last catch by Spurbeck.
Here they've got a safety over the top. You see Spurbeck on the outside, the number one position. They move Cedric Wilson into the slot. They end up doubling Cedric Wilson because he's been torching him over the top all night long. And Spurbeck says, thanks, fellas. I'll take another big pickup and move the chains.
163 for Spurbeck. He averages 108. That's 14th in the nation. And he's already boosted that total in the first half. McNichols. Still not much room for McNichols, although he's going to get a tough run in to get it to the 35. D'Avanzo finally makes a stop.
You remember Doug Martin, the muscle hamster?
Right?
This is kind of like the muscle hamster, too. He's not the biggest guy in the world, but he certainly runs physically, 212 pounds. He's that short kind of stocky build like a pit bull. That means he can lower his pads, play with a low center of gravity, and those are the skills he just used there to move the pile.
On third and four, Rippon to Spurbeck again. There's a stiff arm, and he's into the end zone. What a first half for Spurbeck. Santos misses the tackle. 35 yards. Second touchdown grab, and Boise State is pouring it on. 41-7. Spurbeck nearing 200 receiving yards in the first half. Three touchdown grabs for Wilson, two for Spurbeck. PAT from Rossa, 42-7 Boise State.
Here's Spurbeck right here. Look at the gap in between here. That's 12 yards. Spurbeck's just going to come up and run a simple slant. And it's Ryan Santos in one-on-one coverage with just too big of a cushion. Can't close the gap, can't make the tackle. And another crisp route and a beautiful throw by Brett Rippon. And the Broncos are up big here before halftime. A little bit too much respect on that time. They've been getting torched over the top, so you start to see defensive backs back up. But you give a crisp route runner like Spurbeck that much room, he's going to make you pay for it.
Remember we talked about how Scott Huff and Zach Hill and Brian Harsin all rave about the development of Brett Rippon as a sophomore quarterback. That's 5 touchdowns, 0 INTs in the first half.
Now remember, New Mexico did drop one that hit them in the hands early on. But to your point, yes, this young man is developing, and Bob Davie even saying without question he's going to be an NFL talent. I think it's maybe a little bit premature there, but there's certainly a lot to like about number 4.
So Rippon was forced into duty when Ryan Finley went down. He took over 3 games into the year last year. So Finley had the broken bone in his ankle. So Rippon last year against New Mexico, 3 INTs. He took 3 sacks. Tonight against New Mexico, we're not at halftime yet. The career high, 5 touchdowns, 0 INTs. And he has managed an offense that's put up 42 points in the first half against the Lobos. Jordan to the air. That is incomplete on first down. Intended for Davis.
Well, Lamar Jordan kind of is who he is. He's a great triple option quarterback and a running threat. And it's not his fault that throwing isn't his strong suit. He's a triple option quarterback. You see the same things out of Navy's and the Air Force's and the Georgia Southern's of the world that run the football. Every once in a while, they get a triple option guy that can throw. And it really adds a beautiful dimension to their offense, but this is what he's best at.
Oh, and big lick from Chancellor James on Lamar Jordan. How about the passing difference? New Mexico has 3 passing yards. Boise State has 368. That's a difference of
a lot.
Abacus.
Take your shoes and socks
right off.
Stop counting.
365-yard differential passing total between the two teams.
Good job. Got that iPhone out quick,
right,
didn't you?
Exactly. It was a pretty... Blitz off the edge. Another big hole up the middle for Chesta. That's been the one minus for Boise State. They've given up a couple big ones up the middle.
Yeah, when you try and bring pressure off the edge, your defense flattens out, and it's so important interiorly that you get some good blocks up
front.
But this big offensive line.
18 seconds.
This big offensive line getting things done with some nice zone blocks up front. Right there, a little bit of finish from these guys.
New Mexico's going to use a timeout here.
Probably a pretty good choice, given that there's 18 seconds on the clock. Just hasn't been a lot that's gone right tonight for New Mexico. If you're Bob Davey, I don't even know what you say to your team at halftime, because they've gotten flat-out whipped in every scenario possible. Got to give credit to their offensive line. They've done something against a pretty salty defensive front for the Broncos that nobody's been able to do so far this year. But the self-inflicted wounds are as much of the story of the what's on the scoreboard as anything else.
Jordan, incomplete. Intended for Owens.
I mean, yeah.
Right.
Yeah. That hike was good?
Sure.
How many balloons did you guys see?
I think Jenny counted, I think it's 80 or 90. I counted. There were a couple low-lying ones.
Really good green chili here.
Second and 10. Jordan caught, bobbled and caught. Quarles, that is the second completed pass of the first half for New Mexico. Quarles hauls it in. Out of bounds with 9 seconds. That's a gain of 13.
That was a nice ball there by Lamar Jordan that time on and out. Beautifully placed. And one of the rare completed forward passes we've seen from them tonight. Now with 9 seconds left, you either have two plays. The first one has to be extremely quick because you've got the two timeouts, or you take a couple deep shots at the end zone and hope to get lucky. I think they'll take a deep shot here.
Jordan on the rollout, trying to block it up. There's the deep shot downfield. Anybody's ball. It's incomplete at the goal line.
That should have been pass interference.
There's 1 second on the clock.
That should have been pass interference. Damian Gamblin got grabbed and dragged to the ground, I think. Keep your eye on number two. Push down.
Only would have been a 15-yard penalty.
Gets him closer to the end zone, gives him a better shot.
So one more deep shot for the half for New Mexico. Jordan's going to roll at midfield, heave it to the goal line again. It is intercepted by Boise State. That's Raymond Ford who has the interception to bring the half to an end. Boise State racks up 404 yards of offense and 42 points in the first half. Brett Rippon with three touchdown passes. Three of them go to Cedric Wilson, one to Thomas Spurbeck. Jeremy McNichols has a rushing touchdown, and the Broncos are rolling at the half, 42-7. Half one-sided, 42-7. And as we look at our Bud Light game summary, the numbers are also one-sided. The total yards, 404 in the first half. Nine penalties against New Mexico, and 19th-ranked Boise State well on their way to 5-0. Aaron Taylor, Jenny Dell on the sideline. I'm Carter Blackburn on a windy night in Albuquerque. Aaron's a little less worried about his hair than I am. Boise State, what a statement in the first half.
A statement is a great word, and that's exactly what Brian Harsin wanted his team to do, is come out and make a statement. This allows you to build some depth and do some of those things. Boise State hadn't played this well all season long, and they've just done a remarkable job. It's been a one-sided game. New Mexico's just not good enough to play the way that they played in the first half.
Brett Rippon, five touchdown passes in the first half.
He's been lights out. Taking advantage of one-on-one coverage out on the outside edge. We talked about at the top of the show, one of the things that New Mexico did a really nice job of is creating pressure. You see on all these throws, there's going to be some things in common, and that's that Brett Rippon was allowed to be able to maintain his feet. The pressure was not there. The pocket was there. His offensive line's done a really nice job pass blocking, not so much in the run, and just some great route running by Thomas Spurbeck and Cedric Wilson. The receivers have been a tremendous night. I mean, you look at these numbers here, Carter. Broncos busting out 4-82 to number one, who looks like a baby Von Miller.
With the glasses. Looking solid there for Mr. Wilson. Five touchdown passes. That is tied for the second most by a Boise State quarterback in a game, and Brett Rippon did it in the first half.
I would expect we will see the starters from Boise on both sides of the ball for one series, and then it'll be time to get some good quality, meaningful reps for the backups.
Ross's kickoff brought out of the end zone again. Harris brings it out. Chance for us to check with Jenny.
I asked Coach Davey, what do you do when your team's down 35? What's the message at the half? And he said, we're a family. This is all about pride. None of us want to be in this situation, but we really need to narrow our focus. I asked, how do you stop Boise? He said, we need to play some zone. Obviously, we can't cover them, so we can't play any man-to-man coming up, guys.
And, you know, that was one of the things that New Mexico was clearly worried about going into the game. They were hoping that the pressure would negate some of that weakness in the secondary, but it was not the case in the first half. That's a difference in the drive charts.
I mean, it's just, you look at the first half possessions, punt, touchdown early, things were going well, then a bunch of self-inflicted wounds, four straight punts, and an interception in the first half. Just not the way the Lobos had it drawn up. But it's their own fault, in my opinion. They just hadn't played very disciplined. The opportunities that they had, they negated with foolish penalty after foolish penalty.
This game was 7-7, so 35 unanswered for Boise State. Lamar Jordan, that has been the strength for New Mexico. Keeping the football, running the option. Hoyt makes the stop. Jordan, the junior quarterback, back in the exclusive starting quarterback role because Austin Apodaca, they've rotated back and forth, both the starting role and in games, and Lamar Jordan's been kind of the change of pace, but Apodaca now with a collarbone injury. That was in the Rutgers game on September 17th. Well, New Mexico hoping to have him back soon, but for now it's Lamar Jordan, the junior quarterback. Owens gets to the 30. That's a first down. Ben Weaver makes a stop.
That last series of plays is exactly what New Mexico wants to do. Win on first and second down, have a makeable third down, move the chains and eat the clock up. You notice they're not using any sort of tempo. They're huddling. They're letting the clock run, which on a windy night is appreciated by us upstairs here in the booth. But that is ball control offense, what this style of offense is predicated upon. But they weren't able to get that going in the first two quarters.
Jordan going to keep it again on the option. Takes a big pop as he gets to the 40, near another first down. Chancellor James on the stop with Ford.
This is going to be the one thing that Brian Harsin's not going to be happy with this team. This defense has been outstanding and lights out against the run all year. And they've been whipped at times up front. They've had a couple nice stops, but by and large, New Mexico, with their zone schemes and that triple option, has taken advantage of this defense and had their will at times.
Out of the formation they call the dead eye. The pistol with the eye formation behind it. That's Owens. Minimal gain. He may have lost a yard.
That was a nice job by the left side of that defensive line of getting penetration. You see McCaskill getting in there, number 94. You cross faces up front on the defensive line, good things are going to happen. And they get a one-yard loss as a result.
McCaskill had a sack in the first half. Five on the year now. 18 sacks for this Boise State defense, the most in the FBS. Owens behind Jordan. No option toss. That's Chestnut on the edge, and he is dropped. James, the free safety, comes up to make the stop with Tanner Vallejo.
Boise State players slow to get up there. New Mexico, when they've had their ability to run, it's been up inside between the tackles. Boise's speed is just negating their ability to get to the perimeter as often as they'd like.
Sam McCaskill, the Boise State player, is down on the ground. Just made the tackle for loss, and on the next play, McCaskill's on the turf.
Now, I told you when we started this, we would likely see the starters on both sides of the ball. Now, the game is clearly in hand for Boise State for the most part, but it's very common for coaches, and you see all the exchanges right now. They're putting in their backups because McCaskill goes down, and that's the risk you take when you have your starters out there to try and make a statement to get that one last drive. Boise State has a lot of football left to play. They can't afford to lose number 94, so I'm not surprised at all to see Brian Harsin putting in the backups at this point.
And when we talk about a 42-7 game, if New Mexico was a team that was accustomed to passing the football, running, hurry up, capable of a huge comeback, it'd be one thing. But New Mexico's a team that wants to be methodical, slow, run the football, especially with Jordan at quarterback. You don't have much of a passing game, so... I mean, you made this point all night as Frazier will take down Jordan for the 19th sack of the year. That's Jabril Frazier, the electric sophomore from L.A. His fourth sack of the year.
Yeah, that's Garrett Adcock, the right tackle. We had a chance to talk with this young man. Here he is here, just coming off the outside edge. Just takes a short set, no punch, shortens the corner. And when you have that much length, exactly like Jabril Frazier does, he's going to turn that corner and bend. Nice job with the sack, forcing the punt.
Sam Gentry punting with the wind. Hits it at the 21. Fielded at the 25. Wilson in the punt game. Across the 35. Across the 40 to the 42-yard line. 43-yard punt, 17 on the return from Wilson. Rippon back on the field next.
When I used to fail over and over trying to invent things, everyone said...
Helping make fire and water damage like it never even happened. And by Nissan, premier partner of the Heisman Trophy.
Route 66 rolling through Albuquerque, New Mexico. You can get your kicks on Route 66. Don't forget Winona. Bobby Troop wrote that song. Get your kicks on Route 66. Rippon hands off to McNichols. And he's got it to the 46-yard line. That's been one of the positives for New Mexico. This, not so much. After forcing Boise State into a three and out, the rest of that possession chart looks perfect.
Credit the coaching staff and the players. Clearly, New Mexico was set and intent on stopping that run game and did so, but that created some beautiful one-on-one situations on the outside that they've been able to take advantage of like they are here.
Play action, Rippon to Spurbeck. He was interfered with, so a flag goes down. The one time they've stopped Spurbeck, it's going to be a pass interference, and it's on Marquez Mackey.
Defensive backfield just... outmanned and overmatched tonight.
Pass interference by number 26 of the defense. It's a spot foul and an automatic first down.
Spot foul because it's less than 15 yards.
Season coverage. Spurbeck does a nice job of climbing up on his toes. And Mackey just gets a little handsy. Gets to the top of his vertical stem, turns around, and just grabs him. Easy call.
Motion up front. That'll be another flag on New Mexico.
10.
11.
11. 11 penalties.
Oh. Offside, but number 91 of the defense. It's a 5-yard penalty, and it's still first down.
That's football 101, Carter. I mean, you're standing over the ball. You can't let somebody hard count you. Just watch the football and get off.
Last season, 16, and they won the game. I mean, that is still so stunning that New Mexico, 16 penalties, didn't have a third down conversion, and they won at Boise State. But the Broncos haven't turned the football over tonight, and they have converted the red zone opportunity. Those are the big issues last year when New Mexico was a 30-point underdog, won at Boise.
And it's been a compounding set of issues. It's not just that they had 11 penalties. It's how they had them, where they had them, what it allowed or negated. The timing was just as poor as the frequency.
Second down and 4. Give it to McNichols again. Trying to bounce outside. McNichols has the first down across the 35-yard line. Ryan Santos there on the stop. So McNichols got a touchdown, the rushing touchdown. Make it 17 straight games he's had a touchdown, either receiving or rushing. If he gets a receiving touchdown in the second half, it'll be the 10th game that he's had both a receiving touchdown and a rushing touchdown.
Coming into this game tonight, he had 720 all-purpose yards and 10 touchdowns. There's no mistaking what's the engine that makes this Bronco offense go.
Low snap. McNichols takes it again on first and 10. And McNichols to the 26. So Jeremy McNichols, when you look at both receiving and passing, he is almost 50% of the Boise State offense. And that's going to put you very high. Fourth in touches in the FBS, fifth in scrimmage yards in the FBS for Jeremy McNichols.
Which raises a question, how much longer can you afford to play him in a game that's seemingly in control because you can't afford to get him hurt?
Rippon zips it. Wilson makes the grab. He goes up to get that one. It was off target, and there's Wilson slow getting up as Martin makes a stop.
We had Louisville on our air a couple weeks ago, and Bobby Petrino was playing his guys late when the ball game was in hand. I understand it. I've been on the field. I've been in those huddles. You want to make a statement and finish strong, but you see Wilson, his leg and toe got caught up underneath him. Bad things happen when you leave your starters in there unnecessarily.
Spurbeck goes in motion. Rippon drops over the middle. The check down, that is complete inside the 5-yard line. First and goal. And Sean Monster makes the grab for Boise State. Tonight's red zone in a moment. Brought to you by Verizon. Perfect for Boise State. 3 trips inside the New Mexico 20. 3 touchdowns. After last year, they were just 1-for-6 in the red zone against the Lobos.
Yeah, and only 1-for-1 a week ago against Utah State. I think a lot of people misunderstand red zone. They want you to get close to 100% scoring. Touchdown percentage is much more important in the red zone than overall scoring percentage.
Rippon under center on first and goal. McNichols popped inside the 5. Manages to get close to the 2. It'll be second and goal.
If you're in New Mexico and your defensive coordinator, Kevin Cosgrove, there's going to be a lot of things you're going to see on the film that you're going to like from your ability to be able to stop the run. This front 4 of the Lobos defense, in my opinion, has done a pretty good job of going toe-to-toe with a pretty good offensive line. Pass coverage? Not so much.
The issues have been in the secondary.
But when you're winning in the trenches, that's really a good place to start. But again, I'll keep saying it over and over and over. You have to eliminate the foolish penalties, and that's something that's plagued this team all the way back to a year ago.
Give it to McNichols again. Second and goal. Fighting through tackles. McNichols crosses the goal line. Touchdown, Jeremy McNichols. Second rushing touchdown of the game for McNichols. His 12th total touchdown of the year. And it's 48-7 Broncos.
Jeremy McNichols is not a guy that you can arm tackle. You can't go up high. You better hit him in his legs, wrap and roll. The Lobos don't do it, and he gets in for another touchdown.
We're also on for the PAT. A drive dominated by McNichols on the ground, and another touchdown for Boise State. After the opening three and out, Boise State is perfect. 7-for-7 touchdown drives, and McNichols, only Lamar Jackson of Louisville, has more touchdowns in college football than number 13 for Boise State.
First, they're sharp blades.
Big one tomorrow on the 24-hour 5-0, the number 6 ranking in the country. Navy, we saw them last week against Air Force, their first loss. It's a Navy team that lost a lot off of last year, including a quarterback, Keenan Reynolds.
One of the rare times I've seen Navy get controlled on both sides of the line of scrimmage. Air Force did a nice job, and that happens to be also what Houston does a good job as well. Making matters worse, Cougars have a couple extra days to prepare.
Mexico brings it out again. They'll have it at the 15. Let's take a look at tonight's Vistaprint player profile. Garrett Adcock, the right tackle for New Mexico. He already has his undergrad degree in biology. He told us yesterday he didn't get filed in time for med school. So, hey, get law school taken care of first. He also told us, yeah, I play guitar. I've been playing for a long time, but I'm still pretty bad. Pretty much just C and G back and forth. You can get a long way with that, Garrett. But he's law school and then plans to go to medical school. And with the law degree and the med school degree, Garrett Adcock, probably hospital administration. And his real passion is hospital care in Ghana. And he's made several trips there. And Garrett Adcock, I mean, that's one of the great young men on this New Mexico football team. And as Bob Davey said, he may be governor someday.
Bright kid, really enjoyed our conversation with him. Had a little bit of a tough night in pass protection, but I noticed when we were talking to him, Carter, he has short arms, and that's really hard for a tackle because you have to be able to get that pop and separation, that six-inch punch, and he's just not, doesn't have the physiology to do so.
Jordan Keeper again has a first down across the 30. Got to keep those elbows in tight.
Elbows in. Watching the film from behind, you should never see the elbows. I liked what they were talking about yesterday and the offensive line coach for here at New Mexico, Sanga Tuatele, talking about living in a six-inch world. Your step should never be more than 6 inches. Your punt shouldn't be a windup, should be 6 inches. And that is spot on. Offensive line play is a position of precision, and that is greatly understood, misunderstood by most of the public.
I've been learning a lot about offensive line play via the Twitter.
Got a little bit of clips on there trying to show some examples of what good old line play looks like and just how meaningful it is to winning football.
Yeah, the part of the Joe Moore Award, the award given to the best offensive line unit that Mr. Taylor here has had a huge role in getting rolling, but it has been educational on offensive line play.
And that's the point of the award, really, is to educate fans about the most important position that's the least understood. And I think it's because it's so technical that it's really a process-driven position with no stats. So it's hard for fans to understand and appreciate. And that's among the things that the Joe Moore Award set out to do.
Jordan, well run across the 45-yard line, stringing it out. Looked like he had McCorley on the edge. Forced Boise State to play it out. Jordan moves the chains again. Pierce makes a stop.
And really nice discipline that time by Tanner Vallejo to take the pitch man there. You see him drifting, giving ground. That's not his job to sink back inside. The pursuit has to do that. I think when you look at number 20, he's been such a good player for so many years. averaging 9 tackles a game this year because he plays with that discipline, both with his eyes and his gap integrity, and we just saw it on that last play.
Gap integrity, so critical, especially against the ground game and the option.
Football is a simple game. Each defense dedicates a defender to a gap, which is a space between the blockers along the line of scrimmage. If one person gets out of that gap, that's where the big runs come from.
Jordan's gone over 100 rushing yards in the game.
Got leverage into the boundary.
Straight ahead, McCorley. Now, this is mostly against the twos of the Boise State defense. You still have some of the starters out there for the Broncos, but it just kind of proves the point. If New Mexico had managed to keep this game somewhat close, I mean, they have been able to move the football in the option run game against the Boise State defense, but...
Yeah, there's Ben Weaver, a great look at him by the truck. He's a leading tackler on this team. Darren Lee, number 44, he's out there. They've been banged up at the linebacker position. They still got starters out there in a game that's well under control. Boise State rolling the dice a little bit here from an injury standpoint.
Jordan with a nice fake. Shimmies across the 35. Takes another big pop from James. But Jordan with another 11-yard gain and some chirping going on between the Lobos and the Broncos. They're going to get James out of there in a hurry.
Yeah, there was some free face massages going on down there that time. Lamar Jordan, the quarterback. There was some non-appreciation by the way he was getting tackled. Good job of cutting up inside. But right here at the very end, from the Emmanuel Harris knocking heads off. And James didn't appreciate it, neither would I.
Jordan's going to hand off again. This time it's Darryl Chestnut, the junior from Miami via Coffeyville Junior College. His one touchdown of the year, the opening drive against Rutgers.
I think it's too strong of a statement to say that New Mexico's putting on a clinic up front, blocking Boise, but they're doing a really nice job coming off the football on balance, good pad level. Offensive line play, Carter, is about leverage. Up and down leverage and inside out leverage. Up and down leverage is your pad level. You got to come off low. Inside out leverage is about getting your hands inside on the breastplate of the defender and driving them off the football.
Low man wins.
I wish we could show the fans you do a pass block imitation from here right now.
Gamblin has it on the edge, and James makes a nice play. He's playing motivated. Now, like I say, I've learned a lot from you about offensive line play. I've got the technique down, AT.
Can we shoot up here in the booth and watch Carter Blackburn pass block? Excellent job by Boise's defense, man, setting the edge. That's what you got to do against a triple option. What option teams like to do is get a one-on-one situation. They want to have a defender for the pitch guy. They want to have a defender for the quarterback guy, and then make somebody miss. When you get that advantageous matchup, good things happen. That time, it was 3-2, Boise against New Mexico, and they got a nice stop on second down as a result.
Jordan dropping, has Gamblin on the edge, sends him out. Jordan shimmies out of bounds near the 35. Saw a substitution there on the offensive line as number 69, Bo Hott, checks into the game for New Mexico. So the Lobos getting some more of their twos into the game as well.
Yeah, these are good opportunities to get the backups some meaningful reps. I mean, even though these are Boise's backups, there's still some starters in there. Jabril Frazier, an up-and-coming star, in my opinion, for this defensive line for Boise's out there. He's lined up over here on the left edge. Keep an eye on him.
Fourth down, you're down 42-7. Why not?
There he goes.
Lamar Jordan, incomplete. To the outside, intended for Quarles, so the Broncos will get it back. 58 seconds left in the third. Rush scheme going here with New Mexico in the red tops, red bottoms. Boise State going all white. Kind of looks like Thursday Night Football.
Last game of my career I ever played in the NFL was as a San Diego Charger on the road against the Denver Broncos.
And?
We won. We ran the ball down their throat. And I cried like a baby.
Thomas Stewart, the junior from Baltimore, into the game for Boise State. So Brett Rippon with five touchdown passes. His night appears to be done. Alexander Madison, the ball carrier for Boise State. Now Rippon gets to wear the headset for the rest of the night. 391 passing yards, five touchdowns, and that's his night is done before the fourth quarter begins.
He's played outstanding tonight. Really good decisions. Had one errant throw that he might want back very early in the first quarter. There was an interception that got dropped. But other than that, his location, his decision-making, even throwing the football away at times when he needed to, outstanding. A lot of people have been kind of unfairly on Rippon because of his low completion percentage. And I think people sometimes just look at numbers and think that that tells the whole story. It doesn't. He's got great numbers tonight, but when you watch the film, when there's no fanfare and it's not the TV copy, his decision-making, his mechanics, his footwork, all of that, all the intangibles that it takes to be good at the quarterback position, in my opinion, number four has done an outstanding job tonight.
And he's a sophomore.
Yeah, future's bright.
Thomas Stewart, the junior QB, hit as he throws downfield, and it's incomplete. Intended for Butler, and he took a big pop.
Yeah, that's his second pass attempt of the season, and an ill-advised one. There was pressure. We talked about New Mexico's ability to do that, so he bails the pocket. He's rolling to his right, doesn't get his shoulder around, and gets popped as he threw. Kind of threw the ball up for grabs there on third down. That's why coaches want to get those young players in these situations so they can see that on tape and correct it moving forward.
First punt since the first possession of the game for Boise State when they went three and out. So after seven straight touchdown drives, it's Davis back to return the punt. He'll let it bounce at the 30. Takes a Boise State roll inside the 20-yard line with 1 second left in the third quarter. Here in Albuquerque, .49-7, 1 second left in the third. Well, the Boise State offense has been impressive, but so has the Bronco defense.
Yeah, there hadn't been a whole lot of pass attempts, but there's been great pressure. Sacks galore up front, four of them for Boise State. Done an outstanding job coming into this game. Just done a really nice job of stifling the passing attack of the Lobos. Running game, not so much, but look at that. Tonight, eight tackles for loss. 10th in the FBS coming into tonight's game. But these are the opportunities where the number two defense gets to come in to get those meaningful reps. And it's important that they play well.
Jordan breaks a big one on the last play of the third quarter to the 45. So we go to the fourth with the game well in hand for Boise State. But Lamar Jordan and the Lobos showing a little burst at the end of the third. You're watching College Football on CBS Sports Network. Presented by GEICO. Making the trip down from Boise State to watch the Broncos exact their revenge on the Lobos after the win last year on the blue turf. And it was an excellent weekend here to be in Albuquerque. Check out the balloons, get in a hike in the foothills. This game was 7-7. Since then, all Boise State. I mean, the only reason the score is still 49-7 is the Broncos have pumped the brakes. And bad news for New Mexico, Lamar Jordan is out of the game. It looked like he took a hit on that last rush. So Lawson in at quarterback. He sails that pass incomplete. So this was the last play of the third quarter in the hit that Lamar Jordan took.
He took a big hit. It was just a triple option with a keep read. They had the look that they wanted, one-on-one situation, and he takes it. But keep your eye on number 91 from the backside, who comes and blows him up. That's Durant Miles. Jordan's had a rough night, man. He's taken his fair share of licks, both in the run and pass game. The kids played hard all night long.
So in the fourth quarter, it's Jawan Lawson, the sophomore from Petaluma, California. Second and 10, and he is going to pull it. keep it, take a big pop as he gets across the 50 as we send it back to Brent in New York for an update.
Hey, you guys saw this Tulsa team firsthand back in week one, and you saw this. D'Angelo Brewer, a touchdown. They lead SMU 37-34 in the fourth.
We kind of expected that kind of a shootout, or at least a wild one tonight. Boise State's living up to their end of the bargain. New Mexico's just not been able to get it rolling. Now it's Juwan Lawson trying to get things started.
Coach Davey told us that this kid deserves the play, and he can run and throw the football, which is something that they desperately needed early on in the game.
Lawson gets close, looks like a yard short. Skyler Siebold there on the stop.
Yeah, if you're in New Mexico, you don't even think about this. You go for it. Fourth down, they were 1-for-1 a week ago, and one of the better things they do in the country on fourth down.
I was going to say, they're built for going for it on fourth down anyway.
Yeah, no question. And considering that Boise State has a lot of their twos out there defensively, this is a non-decision. Inside zone.
Hand off, first down, McCorley gets it to near the 40. So New Mexico converts on fourth down. Let's check with Jenny.
Well, AT, you just said some number twos out there. The D-line coach, Steve Caldwin, went over to Chase Hatutta, who jumped on the bike. He said, get loose. You're going to go in there and take some snaps. And everyone on the sideline is cheering for him right now. It's a great scene down here.
All right.
Man, I remember those days when you were a starter, you're out there taking your finger tape off and seeing your buddies out there. Because these guys, everybody works as hard, whether you're a starter or a backup. So for these young guys to get a chance to go out there in a game, man, there's nobody rooting harder for them than the teammates and the guys that play in front of them.
Lawson hands off and Owens gets pushed back. Here in Albuquerque, where James McGill has practiced law. Walter White has been a biology teacher. Aaron Paul is from Boise, Idaho. Played Jesse Pinkman on the television program. So the Albuquerque and the Boise ties are strong.
Very strong.
There's the handoff to Woodhouse as he gets near the 40-yard line. Well, you think about the undefeated. We showed you those undefeated teams in the group of five, Boise State and Air Force, two from the Mountain West Conference. You have Houston playing Navy tomorrow on CBS Sports Network. There's a possibility of a game with huge implications Thanksgiving weekend in the Mountain West Conference. Boise State at Air Force.
That would be a huge game if both of these teams can stay undefeated. Everybody was looking forward to the undefeated game and the championship game, assuming that San Diego State would have been undefeated from the West Division and Boise obviously being undefeated from the Mountain Division, but that loss to South Alabama squashed that. Now that Air Force-Boise game on Thanksgiving weekend, to your point, Carter, looks a lot more juicy.
Well, you think about it. San Diego State had been able to beat South Alabama, which they were not last week. You would have had three teams from the Mountain West Conference on this list. San Diego State still undefeated in conference play, and you still have the possibility of a big win in the Mountain West Championship game. But Boise State, Air Force, again, they meet Thanksgiving weekend on CBS Sports Network. And that could be a very impactful game for the Mountain West Conference and for the group of five and the New Year's Six possibility.
Another fourth down here.
On fourth and one, New Mexico picks it up. The second fourth down conversion of the drive. That's Daquan Woodhouse, the sophomore from Altus, Oklahoma. He's coming back from a hip injury. Woodhouse is a guy who gives him a pretty good burst in the backfield as well.
Yeah, he's 5'9", 188 pounds, and certainly a change of pace. We talked about the importance of the running back by committee, but how about this New Mexico team? Not a lot's gone right for him tonight, but this is the 10th play of this drive, their longest of the night.
Red one. Lawson scrambling on first down, has a seam inside the 20-yard line, inside the 15 for the sophomore QB, Jawan Lawson.
See Lawson reading that end and crashes down. He keeps it inside. I love this kid's open field running. Does a nice job of stretching the plays out, which stresses the defense, puts them in a bind where they have to make a decision. They end up getting caught in no man's land, not knowing who to tackle, and Lawson's a beneficiary.
First red zone trip tonight for New Mexico.
Uncharted territory. Hard to believe.
Lawson hands off McCorley on the edge inside the 10. They'd like to get it to McCorley in the red zone inside the 10. Had three touchdowns in the win over San Jose State last week.
Thought that was a great decision by McCorley to get north and south. Sometimes backs, there's a player down for Boise, sometimes backs like to dance around and try and stretch it out. Put your foot in the ground, get north and south, get lined up on second down. Nice 4-yard gain.
And while they tend to the injured Bronco, Chase Itata, we step aside.
You need a website. Why not do it yourself? With Wix, you can create your own professional website. Drag and drop to create your site exactly the way you want.
Boise State is ranked in the top 25 for the 15th consecutive year. Presently at 19, we take a look at the top 10 in the AP poll, powered by Ram Trucks, and including 6th-ranked Houston at Navy. And the big top 10 matchup in the SEC, Home Depot. SEC on CBS with Tennessee versus Texas A&M.
Yeah, I can tell you, 3:30 on Saturday, there's going to be four of the best defensive linemen in the country going at it. I think the offensive line that plays the best in that game will likely win it. And that's why I picked Texas A&M. That's one of the greatly improved positions on that team. And one of the questions that they hadn't been able to answer until this year. And they may be in the playoffs because of it.
Here's Jawan Lawson, the third string quarterback for New Mexico. With Apodaca unavailable to go, Lamar Jordan taking a big hit at the end of the third. Now it's Lawson, the sophomore QB, quarterback in the fourth.
Going back to Texas A&M, I wonder if we've seen peak hurry-up, no-huddle spread, Carter. At the end of the day, if you can't run the football or stop the run, you just simply can't win championships. Even when they had Johnny Manziel and throwing it all around, that lack of the run game that's hurt Ole Miss and hurt all those teams. The reason Alabama's dominated is because they went in the trenches, and you have to run and stop the run if you want to win meaningful football games.
On third and 8, Lawson pulls it, pressured. On the roll, he's gonna scramble. Big block as he dives to near the 10-yard line. That was Emmanuel Harris who threw a huge block on the edge. Lawson didn't get the first down, but close to it.
You know how they say you got to know your role?
Right.
Well, Emmanuel Harris had one catch on the year coming into the night. We're week 6. Number 15's role is to light people up on the outside edge, and he's done a pretty remarkable job of that tonight. At times.
The junior from Dallas Skyline High School. Yeah, that's 49-7. Who cares? You lay a lick like that, you get some dabs coming back the sideline.
No doubt, but that's what coaches want to see, man. Even when the game's out of control, how do you play? How do you respond? Do you play with pride or not?
Lawson pulls it into the end zone. Touchdown, Jawan Lawson. First career touchdown as a Lobo. And the game may be well in hand, but that's a nice moment for that young man, Jawan Lawson, leading the touchdown drive.
You said it, bud. This is great for him, great for this team to fight hard. Granted, it's Boise's twos out there, and there's going to be some splaining to do for them on that side of the football. But as bad as New Mexico's played tonight, as much as they've shot themselves in the foot, I don't think these guys have quit and given up, and that's encouraging.
Jason Sanders gets the PAT, and Jawan Lawson gets the congratulations from his teammates. Into the game in the fourth, and the sophomore QB into the end zone for the first time. Concert with Al Hurricane and Al Hurricane Jr.
Jr.
But it has not been the Friday night performance that the Lobos wanted against Boise State, trailing 49-14. That'll be a touchback, sending us to a timeout. 49-14 lead here in Albuquerque. Let's take a look at our Geico difference makers, the three big weapons of the first half for Boise State. Brett Rippon, 391, five touchdowns. Two of those touchdowns went to Thomas Spurbeck, who had 198 receiving yards before his night was done. And three more touchdown passes to Cedric Wilson. He had two coming in, three in the first half. A career night for Cedric Wilson, the junior from Memphis, via Coffeyville Community College to Boise State. So now, I mean, that's a lot of yards right there between McNichols and Wilson and Rippon. And they're watching now as the backups are in the game. Thomas Stewart is the quarterback. Brian Wolpen in at running back. So, yeah, you get to chill out a little bit. And think about this Boise State team. There have been so much talk about, all right, they lost four games last year. That's like panic button around Boise with the success they've had since 2000. Winningest program in the FBS since 2000. But you lose four games, and there was talk of the redemption road of the 2016 season, including New Mexico. You got to go on the road and beat New Mexico and get that one back from a season ago. Well, boy, have they gotten that one back tonight.
Yeah, and it's not just the fact that they've won. It's the style and the fashion that they've done it. You mentioned those four losses a year ago. In 2015, Boise finished plus nine, but in their four losses, they were minus six in the turnover margin. They protected the football tonight. They continue to do that down the rest of this stretch. When you look at their schedule, they're going to be all right. BYU is a much improved football team, but you look at that schedule, they got to get past BYU, and that November 18th game against Air Force could be for all the marbles, and that prize New Year's Six spot, which is not only big for them but financially for the conference, it would be a benefit as well. And that's what was so disappointing about San Diego State's loss to South Alabama.
No question. And so that would, you have two divisions in the Mountain West Conference, so Boise State competing in the Mountain Division, so that's why that Air Force Boise State matchup could be for the division at the end of the year, and then San Diego State on the other side in the West Division for the Mountain West Championship game. Fourth and two coming up here. Looks like Boise State's going to punt, but bigger picture for the Broncos. How good of a chance does this Boise State have of being, for the second time in 3 years, a New Year's Six buster?
Well, I think they're well on their way, but they have to continue to improve. I think they certainly did that in the passing game tonight. New Mexico did a nice job up front taking away the run game, but the balance of the passing attack really carried them to do what it is that they needed to do. All the pieces of the puzzle are here. They just got to keep continuing to get better and make sure that they handle business. But right now, tonight, Boise up big, 49-14, late in the fourth. Make it likely, but if that game doesn't get played, it could have serious, serious implications. And a lot of people have been critical about the lack of leadership in the SEC, or the alleged lack of leadership.
New Mexico calls their first time out of the half.
And the fact that they didn't have a contingency plan, when we see so many other games getting moved or playing on Sunday in the same area. And this is a blemish, and a lot of people think the first black eye on Greg Sankey as he leads the nation's best conference.
Timeout, New Mexico, 49-14. Do you think LSU has a chance to go undefeated under interim head coach Ed Orgeron the rest of the way?
I don't know. I really like what I saw a week ago, and I like the way that they changed things up offensively. Now, when you have a short week, you can't wholeheartedly and wholesalely change your offense. So what you do is you change your play calling. They threw on fourth or first down 40% of the time, so they mixed it up. They ran different personnel packages, a lot more three and four wide receivers than they had. They've had a good defense. It's been the lack of offense that's been the problem. So even with Leonard Fournette out, Darius Geis has done a really nice job. Teams historically have played really well underneath Orgeron. I think it's fully possible that they could make a run.
on the reverse, Damian Gamblin from Mesquite, Texas.
And that was the thing. When they wanted to move that game with Florida to November 19th, Florida wanted to do that, but LSU didn't. That would have been three back-to-back road games for LSU in 13 days. I wouldn't want to do that either.
Can't blame them. Well, for Bob Davey in New Mexico, you're going to fall to 2-3. It's a program that was hoping to capitalize on the momentum last year. Mentioned earlier, Lawson shoving his way for a first down. But last year was the first winning season in the first bowl in 9 years. Last time that New Mexico has had back-to-back winning seasons, 04 and 05. It's a program that hasn't won an outright conference title since 1963. So the building blocks were going to be a winning season. You get to a bowl game, you come back 2016. 2-3 right now, there's going to be opportunities ahead, especially if New Mexico can get healthy again. I mean, this is a different team if you have Apodaca and Jordan. You see Lawson in there now. You get healthier again on the defensive side. You still have a chance of getting to that 6-7 wins and a chance at a winning season in back-to-back bowl games. The one that really hurt them on the schedule was the loss at New Mexico State.
Yeah, there's no question. That's a game that they have to win, but an in-state rival, those things happen. Shoot, San Diego State lost to South Alabama. Going on the road next week to Air Force, that's never an easy place to play. At Hawaii, that's never an easy place to play. You look at the remaining schedule, there's four away games in conference. They're going to have to get healthy in a hurry, but you're right. A team like this just simply can't afford to be hurt and have injuries at critical positions. The margin of error is too slim for a team built like New Mexico.
So again, it's Juwan Lawson, the third string quarterback in there now after the injuries to Apodaca and Lamar Jordan. Boise State going to go to 5-0.
Rightfully so. This was, when we have our coaches' meetings, I always like to ask a couple questions. What's the thing that you're happiest with about your team, and what's the thing that you would like to see them improve to take the next step? When I asked Brian Harsin that, he said, we haven't put anybody away. We haven't been definitive in winning and putting the dagger in teams when we've had the chance. Well, they've done that tonight. There's going to be a lot that they'll see on the film that they like, that they can build upon. And that confidence is going to serve them well down the stretch as they make a run to stay undefeated and possibly play not only for the conference championship, but in a big-time bowl game on a national stage.
Now Lawson a little bit humbled after that last one. You talk about, you know, Boise State. You have the 2009 Fiesta Bowl. Winning his program since 2000. The 2006 Fiesta Bowl, that was the big thriller to beat Oklahoma in the Fiesta Bowl. They did it again in 09 to beat TCU in the Fiesta Bowl. Then the New Year's Six, that was the most unlikely one because first year under head coach Brian Hartman, they started 3-2.
That's right.
And then rallied to win the Mountain West, be the New Year's Six representative in the Fiesta Bowl, beat Arizona in that Fiesta Bowl. So, you know, when you're talking about Boise State, it's the level of success and the level of expectations has been so high, especially since 2000. You go back even further than that. They won the junior college national title in 58. They were the 1AA national champs in 1980. So it is a long winning tradition for Boise State football at several levels. As you see Woodhouse take that one inside the 20-yard line. They're going to have a chance to add to that tradition this year.
Yeah, they certainly are. And I think the thing that's allowed Boise to be successful is there's been consistency. I mean, there's no question that Chris Peterson took this program to the next level. And you look at what he's doing out west in the Pacific Northwest at Washington. That team is built just like all his good Boise State teams were. I think what people underappreciate and have undervalued with the Boise State football teams, they get locked on to the Drinkwitzes and the Kellen Moores and all the quarterback play, but it's really teams built upon winning on the line of scrimmage. Tenacious defense, athletes on the outside, but an offensive line that can establish the
run. A false start by number 62 of the offense. It's a 5-yard penalty, and it's still first down. Timeout, New Mexico, to avoid the 10-second runoff. 30-second timeout.
That timeout will allow us to check out our Serve Pro play of the game. One of the three touchdown grabs by Wilson tonight for Boise State. And Cedric Wilson managed to not only get that football, keep the foot in for the touchdown.
He got both feet in for the touchdown. And we talked at the beginning of the game about this young man being an emerging rising star. And I think they've certainly got one. He had his one-on-one matchups, and as a receiver, you have to win those. Those are the things you lick your chops for. And he certainly delivered, and I think that gives a lot of confidence to that young man we're looking at right there wearing number 4.
The only reason there's only 49 on the board is because Boise State pulled up the reins. I mean, if they had left Rippon and the rest of the offense out there, they could have kept scoring.
Lamar Jordan back in a quarterback.
Jordan to the air, to the end zone, and incomplete. Intended for Q Drennan, redshirt freshman from El Paso.
There was some minor incidental contact on that last play, but I think it was a good decision, with as windy as it is up here, by the officials not to throw that flag.
2 for 12.
Yeah, throwing the football is not his strong suit. But, man, he made some plays with his legs tonight. And he gave everything he had. He got banged up, and here he is back out here trying to get some last-minute points before this game ends.
Lamar Jordan. There goes right back to number 9, Q Drennan. 29 seconds. And Lamar Jordan was a guy who had planned to go to Arkansas as a wide receiver, but that was when Bobby Petrino wrecked his Razorback tenure. So Jordan caught up in that coaching change, ended up as a Lobo. And again, it has been a saga at quarterback for Jordan. Uses the change of the pace.
Timeout, New Mexico, their final timeout of the half.
Final timeout of regulation.
I know a lot of people are probably wondering why you're calling a timeout, but game football is a game of competition, and I agree with it. And at the same token, man, I think it's cool that they're giving Lamar Jordan an opportunity to throw the football at the end of this game. They're not running him as a triple option quarterback. I think this is a situation where you try to build the young man's confidence throwing the football. He just had a completion there. It's been a rough night for him throwing the football. But I would imagine the decision to have him in here at this game is to get some of that stank out of his mouth on what's been a pretty rough night.
Only 27 passing yards for Lamar Jordan, but he's rushed for 139.
These guys didn't quit. I'll give New Mexico that.
Jordan to the air, to the end zone, caught, touchdown. So the timeout, the effort to get Lamar Jordan a touchdown pass, works out. First touchdown pass of the year for Lamar Jordan. Samoa hauls it in, and Jordan finishes off the touchdown drive. So if the goal of that last possession for New Mexico was to give Lamar Jordan a little boost at the end, mission accomplished.
I think so, but he didn't seem too thrilled, man. It's been a long night for him. But they went out there and competed, and as silly and meaningless as a touchdown like that seems, when you watch the film and you see it done right, even though it's against Boise's number 2s, it is something positive that can help your football team grow.
49-21. That's the first touchdown pass of the year for Lamar Jordan. Actually, had one last year against Boise State in a win. That's a begrudging acceptance of congratulations. for number 13, the junior QB from Frisco, Texas. So 49-21, 20 seconds left. And what is going to be a Boise State win here to send them to 5-0. And when we're done here in Albuquerque, it is back to New York for Inside College Football presented by Go RVing. And not only a recap of a pretty busy Friday night in college football, but a look ahead at Saturday, including the top 10 matchup in the SEC between Texas A&M and Tennessee.
Yeah, that's a matchup I think we're all looking forward to see. Tennessee, man, you just have to wonder how much more gas they have in the tank of those late game heroics. Texas A&M, the thing that's been problematic for them is stopping the run and running the football, but also the quarterback position. They get Trevor Knight and finally bring some leadership versus talent alone at that quarterback position, and I think that's made all the difference for the Aggies.
Oh, by the way, and let's see, less than 12 hours, Texas plays Oklahoma, and it is barely on the national radar.
Yeah, man. The Big 12's hanging on, and a lot of people are wondering whether or not Oklahoma's going to cost the Big 12 a shot in the college football playoff. I just don't think that Baylor and West Virginia are good enough and have enough depth. Baylor's already had some injuries this week at the defensive line, and historically those teams have started fast and kind of fizzled out down the stretch. You just wonder if this isn't going to be the Big 12's year once again.
So Stewart will take a knee, and Boise State wins it 49-21. The Broncos are 5-0. Big smile for Brian Harsin, for Brent Rippon, and Boise State. Because after a stunning loss to New Mexico last November, 1-4 in the regular season, Boise State brings it on the road to Albuquerque and dominates 49-21, the final one. It was well in hand long before. So the first 5-0 start since 2011. Harsin and the Broncos meets Bob Davey at midfield. And a big time win, 49-21 for Aaron Taylor, Jenny Dell, our entire crew. I'm Carter Blackburn. This has been a presentation of CBS Sports Network, the 24-hour home of CBS Sports. So we'll send you on to New York, Inside College Football with Brent, Houston, Christian, and Jimmy. So long from Albuquerque.
Junior!